lady we've all been waiting for.
Hello, my name is Foxy Tan, and I am, rightfully, known as the boss of Burlesque, bringing you yet another edition of The Big Reveal.
Let's go, boys!
A program dedicated to highlighting the often secret history of the origins of modern burlesque. Today, we explore the lesser-known origins of the fan dance. Today, in modern burlesque, the image of the fan dancer is seen absolutely everywhere. But interestingly enough, the actual origin of the fan dance, there's a little bit of controversy. Now, traditionalists, they set the beginning of the fan dance all the way back to ancient Japan, to the reign of Emperor Jimmu, where the fan dance was actually a respectable sort of an addendum to a royal formal tea ceremony. Closer to home and centuries later, American audiences were agog when Sally Rand appeared with her feathery shimmy shield at the World's Fair in Chicago in 1933. Considered by many lesser scholars to be the very moment when the routine made its appearance in the good old US of A, but actually, there is an event from 1932 that I feel bears merit. In the city of Philadelphia, at a venue called the Trocadero, there was a vaudeville show that was showing the obligatory animal acts. Now, don't get me wrong, at the Trocadero, they were very family friendly. It was all the rage, quite unlike all the shows that were going on in Tijuana at the time. But still, society's provisions within vaudeville were tightly monitored and discretion was mandatory. On October 11th, the trained singing ostriches of Professor Featherwhistle had just finished their Gilbert and Sullivan medley, which was considered to be the second worst act of the night. Now, on to the point. Now, the animal act was exiting the stage when the hostess comedian, Maud Ville, I love that name. Isn't that just the best fucking name you've ever heard, Maud Ville? Seriously. Well, she entered in her funniest fruit hat. However, her fruit-tastic dress snagged on the footlights and she watched it burn instantly to her horror. In a desperate act of proper coverage in order to fend off the police, she grabbed onto the male ostrich nearest to her, Quincy by chance, and attempted to conceal her nude figure by remaining behind the bird. This antic drew massive applause that terrified the bird, which reacted rather violently, and began to run about the stage. Now, the audience, having never seen such a thing, went wild. Presuming that it was all part of the act, Maud held on to that manic bird for over 3 minutes. Their struggle only worsened as time clicked on. In the end, feathers floated through the air like Ridley Scott's legend. Now, the producer of the show clearly saw the value of such a spectacle, and so did a young Sally Rand. In the third row that night, sadly, Maud was gutted in one sweeping motion by the bird's giant leg. Still, the bar had been set. Audiences knew then what they wanted, and it somehow involved ostriches. Several other little-known burlesque newbies attempted to emulate Maud's swan song act, but those two all ended in gory, violent death. Indeed, it was considered poor judgment to keep using the same ostrich, though some have suggested that it was a conscious decision on the part of the producer, Marvin Merkin, to sell tickets. What began as a hellscape of fear soon blossomed into the single most prolific gimmick to ever attach itself to burlesquery. Today, the fan dance is considered the Rolls Royce of the cabaret. Only when done well, of course. The fan dance is also slagged as the pinto of the burly stage when it is paraded out by every single first-year greenhorn. And thank you for joining us for this episode of The Big Reveal. And don't forget to tune in next time where we will be bringing you some of the craziest shit that has never been heard of. Catch you later. It's time for a shot. Honey,
Sugar nipples, can you bring me some wild turkey? Please, where I'm fucking tethered, Jesus.